It's not often, I don't think, that people really give thought to the entire structure of signification and how it's worked out. So one of the important innovations, I think, that Jacques Lacan makes in his thinking is that he, especially in the early to middle seminars, lays out a particular idea of the structure of signification and how the subject itself relates to this signifying structure. So what's interesting is that early linguists and semioticians thought about the structure of signification, but they didn't include subjectivity in it. And I think the important thing is to understand that the structure of signification exists, but it doesn't exist without a subject. And the subject isn't just the product of that structure of signification. The subject actually collides with that structure of signification. And I want to talk about how the structure works, how it's set up, and then how that collision takes place and what results from it. Let's explore the structure of signification, or the signifying structure. It begins, as we might expect, with the first signifier. And Jacques Lacan calls this the master signifier. That is, the master signifier is the foundation of signification. That itself doesn't have a foundation. So it starts signification, but it itself is groundless. And this is a really important concept to get down, that the master signifier itself doesn't refer back to another signifier, another ground. It just refers to itself. It's self-referring. So without the master signifier, we have no world of signification at all. So it's the signifier that starts signification, that creates a signifying universe. And one of the ways that Lacan labels the master signifier is that he calls it S1, which just means first signifier, signifier one. And it's a nice shorthand to designate it. So as the master signifier, this S1 is a signifier without a signified, which means it doesn't have any signification. It signifies itself. So master signifier, what is the definition of master signifier? The master signifier. That is, there's no reference to any other terms that would define it. So we could call it, I think, an idiotic signifier, because precisely it doesn't refer to anything else. So every other signifier has a sense through its relation to other signifiers, whereas the master signifier, because it has no other signifiers behind it, grounding it, providing a foundation for it, it's idiotic. So we can look at the difference between God, say, and a table. Right? So God is, famously says, I am what I am, like Popeye the Sailor Man. God is what he is, right? Like, there's no signified for God. And every signified we come up with, omnipotence, omniscience, omnipresence, they all are inadequate to fully capture that master signifier. In contrast, table, we can define pretty easily. It has a clear signified. You bring a chair up to it, you sit at it, you put things on it, you can eat on it. All these other signifiers we can use to define what table is, and we can get a pretty good idea of what it is with those other signifiers. So God is, we don't know. The table is what we can define through how it relates to other signifiers. So this is an important lesson from Ferdinand de Saussure, that signifiers gain their meaning through their relation to other signifiers. So he famously says that the signification is a structure without a positive term. Which he means by that is every signifier is defined by its relationality to other signifiers, except, this is not Saussure's point, this is Jacques Lacan's point, except the master signifier, which only signifies itself. Let's look at a joke about God to make sense of this. So a conspiracy theorist comes to heaven and he can't wait to get there. And Peter tells him, okay, you can ask God one question. And he goes, okay, God, who really killed John F. Kennedy? And God says, you know what? It was Lee Harvey Oswald. It was a single gunman. There were nobody else involved. And the conspiracy theorist goes, wow, it goes even higher than I thought it did. So what's great about this joke is it doesn't take God as the master signifier, right? So God, in this joke, there's another signifier behind God that has the real final answer. So you can think of master signifier as the point at which conspiracy theories or questions stop. That's the final answer. But in this case, God doesn't have the final answer. So there's an God, another God behind, according to this conspiracy theorist, who really has the answer. Now, we can think of the nation as a very important and common form that the master signifier takes. So, for instance, American, right? There's no definition of what it means to be American, and yet it functions as a master signifier for a lot of people. Or today, I think for maybe an equal number, science functions as a master signifier. And I think most people would say, well, science is a better master signifier than America, or better master signifier than God. And sure, but the point is not necessarily what master signifier we take up, but how we relate to that master signifier. I think that's a very significant and important point, that it's not necessarily the content of the master signifier, but our formal relation to it that really matters. So the master signifier is S1. The problem is, the reason why it doesn't have a clear signification or meaning is that there's not a second signifier that would put a clear end to meaning and punctuate the sentence, we might say. So S1, the master signifier, is the beginning of the sentence, and there's no final word. That's what, when we say there is no S2, that S2 is missing, what we really mean is there's no final word. Like, where's the final word? It's not given. We don't have it. So we get this problem. What does it mean to be American? What is God? What is science? I think equally difficult question. So the master signifier commands the subject to obey, to accept its symbolic law. And that's all it does. So the master signifier is not so much a declarative, although it does say this is how things are, but it's even more an imperative, act like this. So every master signifier, we could say, is an imperative that says no, or act this way, you have to do this. So to be an American, you must do this. To follow God, you must just do this. To follow science, you must do this. So let's be clear, I'm not equating science and God or science and American nationalism. I'm just saying it functions as a master signifier in a similar way. And what the master signifier does is it prohibits the subject from having it all, from attaining completion, which, what's interesting is, this is already impossible because there is no binary signifier, no completion, no end of the sentence, right? So no subject could have it all anyway, but the master signifier prohibits this on the part of the subject. So it prohibits an impossibility. S1, the first signifier, the master signifier, requires an S2, we call a binary signifier, in order to have a signification. But as we just seen, S2 doesn't exist. There is no final end of the final last word. So there is no S2 as a second signifier to put an end to determine what S1 or the master signifier means. So we have all these master signifiers. God is, as an American is, science is, and we don't have how we would complete the sentence. We don't have an end point because there isn't a binary signifier in S2 to provide an ending for us. And this absence of a binary signifier means that whatever signification we have for S1, will always be contingent and arbitrary depending on the stopping point that we have. Since there is no final word, we have to stop some point to have signification. So where we stop is always going to be contingent. And in the absence of the binary signifier, S2 really is just knowledge. So we fill in this absence of a binary signifier, this absence of a final word, we fill it in with what? We fill it in with knowledge. So we accumulate knowledge to try to make up for the absence of this second signifier that would complete the sentence, that would complete signification, but no amount of knowledge can do it. It always comes up short. So knowledge fills in for the absence of a complete signification, but knowledge remains incomplete. So we're stuck with an incomplete structure, a structure that's constantly going on. But in order to have any signification at all, we need that going on to stop at some point. Otherwise, every signification would just be open. We would never know what anybody meant when they spoke, yet we do know what people mean when they speak. So knowledge, it's ultimately dissatisfying because it cannot provide the completion that would give us the signification of S1. So however much knowledge we accumulate, it's never enough knowledge. One cannot know the signification of S1 precisely because this binary signifier S2 is constitutively absent. So the absence of S2 makes the signification of S1 impossible. And we're able to speak and generate new signification precisely because there's no S2. So if there was an S2, you could still imagine there being a symbolic structure, a structure of language, but no one would be able to speak in it because it would be completely closed off. So the fact that we can't lament the fact that there's no S2, because it gives us the capacity to make the lament in the first place. So we couldn't, if S2 existed, if a binary signifier existed, there would be no capacity to form speech. But what we have instead of S2, we have knowledge, but we also must have a stopping point which creates signification. Now this works when we're just forming a sentence, when we put a punctuation point mark at the end of the sentence, right? So I loved her, period. I loved him, period. Like that period allows us to understand the significance of those two sentences. This works, however, with the larger symbolic structure as well. And this is a point that Jacques Lacan calls the point de capitan or the quilting point. What's interesting is this is a term that comes from quilting, actually. The activity of quilting, and the quilting point functions like a punctuation mark that ends the sentence and determines the meaning of it. So the quilting point is metaphorically this punctuation mark, and then it holds down sense. It holds down the significance of S1. And Lacan calls this quilting point. This is very interesting. He calls it, uses this abbreviation a couple of times. He calls it S-A, signified, so the S is small, so which means signified, of the other. A here is autre in French, other. So the signified of the other. So it's the meaning, the signification of what the other is. And here we can look at an actual quilt, and you can see the way in which the quilting points hold the material that's within the quilt in place. So it's a really interesting metaphor because the quilting point actually does physically what Lacan says the quilting point has to do structurally in language. So what happens is you get a quilting point and then it works retroactively to produce a stable signification for S1 or the master signifier. So the effect of the quilting point is always one of, this is a term from Freud, it's in German, Nachträglichkeit, or retroactivity, or Other people have called it belatedness. It goes backwards. Après coup is how it's translated in French. So it's an effect that happens, something happens later, the quilting point, and it retroactively causes something that happens earlier in time, that is the significance of S1 or the master signifier. So the quilting point actually stands in for the absence of S2, that we don't have a binary signifier S2. We don't have an end point in language. So instead we get these quilting points that put a stop to significance and allow us to have a significance for S1, or at least a contingent temporary significance for S1. So let's take the master signifier God. What's the quilting point? Well, I think it's often evil or sin. So these are the things that we know. How do I know what God is? Well, God is not sin. And that's how I can define what God is. So the quilting point often functions as a negative point, what the thing is not. And in the case of the master signifier American, it's pretty easy to see that the quilting point is something like communist or even maybe socialist. So that quilting point, that negative that American is not, allows you to understand what American is, which is why the idea of the Red Scare is so prevalent in 20th century American, 21st century American history, because the quilting point is necessary to define the master signifier American. And these figures of communism are so beloved in America precisely because, I mean this in the Freudian sense, they're hated but loved also, the ambivalence. They're also loved because they provide a quilting point for what it means to be American. And we can come together as Americans around this quilting point. So I know I'm an American because I know that I'm not a communist. This reminds me of the best joke I know about Americans. Someone discovers a smart American on their travels through the United States, and someone says to them, "What do you call a smart American?" And the person goes, "A tourist." So I that's my favorite American joke, because it perfectly captures the idiocy of that master signifier American. And I know that I'm that because I'm not a communist. Let's look at my favorite example of an attempt to define America through not being a communist.
I can no longer sit back and allow communist infiltration, communist indoctrination, communist subversion, and the international communist conspiracy to sap and impurify all of our precious bodily fluids.
So communism takes aim even at our precious bodily fluids through the process of fluoridating water, which is interesting that that was a right-wing conspiracy when Stanley Kubrick made this film in 1964, and now it's a left-wing conspiracy theory today. So it's a sad trajectory that theory has gone along. All right, so let's look at the structure of signification in abbreviated terms. So we have S1, beginning point of signification, master signifier. We have S2, accumulation of knowledge, other signifiers that come in. And then we have signified of the other, the point, the quilting point, that retroactively determines the signification of S1. And this retroactive power of the quilting point is nicely shown, I don't think there's a better example, in the radical shift that occurs in the Francis Ford Coppola film, his masterpiece, The Conversation. So what happens is Harry Call, the main character, discovers that he has inadvertently helped two people kill the chairman of a corporation. And he thought he was actually contributing to their murder, and he was really upset about it. He bugs people. And so what he discovers in the little clip I'm going to show you is that the significance of what he heard radically changed once he realizes that the director has been killed and not the couple. Let's take a look at this.
There's an enemy within the couple.
It's not hurting you.
Neither are we. Oh, God.
Can't stand it.
You think we can do this?
Later in the week. Sunday, maybe.
Sunday, definitely.
Jack Tar Hotel. 3 o'clock. Room 773. You'd kill us if you got the chance.
What's amazing about that sequence is that Harry Call has edited together, or mixed together, would be a better way to put it, the sound. And so the emphasis is he'd kill us if he had the chance, which changes the entire meaning, because earlier it was he'd kill us if he had the chance. So it's fascinating about the way in which a signifier that comes later and quilts can change the meaning of something that happened earlier. So a different punctuation mark, a different point of punctuation, a different quilting point can change the significance of the master signifier. So everything is reinterpreted when we introduce a new quilting point. So this happens all the time, that something like when the Soviet Union fell, all of a sudden a new quilting point was introduced, and we had to reinterpret the whole struggle against the Soviet Union undertaken by the United States. So it's a very fascinating thing that the quilting point has this power to work against temporality, to actually change what happens in the past and the significance of what's happened in the past. So the structure, this process that goes master signifier, knowledge, quilting point, always includes also a missing signifier, a signifier that's impossible, that can't appear, that's primordially repressed, and it is the signifier of the barred other, the signifier of the lack in the other, the signifier of the incompletion of the symbolic structure. So the structure is incomplete. Why is it incomplete? Because there's one signifier missing, which is the signifier of its incompletion. So this signifier of the barred other, the signifier of the symbolic structure's incompletion, is the source of all possibility within the signifying structure. I think this is the absolutely key point. This missing signifier is, as I say, the signifier of the barred other, the signifier that indicates the failure of the other to cover everything. But the problem is, the repression of SA isn't just the result of SA barred, isn't just the result of what a couple people have done or what a regime has done. It's primordially repressed in Freud's terms, which means it cannot appear. It's the basis, its repression is the basis for the emergence of the symbolic structure itself. So this missing signifier SA barred is an absence that's actually included and accompanies every act of signifying. So whenever we signify something, this absence is accompanying it. This missing signifier, this primordially repressed signifier of the lack and the other is accompanying it. And this signifier of the lack and the other is what cannot be said, but what nonetheless accompanies everything that is actually said. So even though there are certain signifiers that can occupy the position of this signifier of the barred other, this signifier actually cannot appear itself within the signifying structure. It's an impossibility. So all we can do is point to this impossibility, show indications of this impossibility. So this signifier of the lack and the other remains a permanent opening, and it indicates how the other fails, that there's a failure within the symbolic structure. And this missing signifier of the barred other is thus the site of all emancipatory politics. So every political action that tries to create some kind of emancipatory change has to take the site where there's something missing as its point of departure. This is an absolutely crucial point, I think. So instead of identifying with a symbolic position, one can instead identify with this signifier of the lack, and the other, this signifier of a site of impossibility. The symbolic structure says this is impossible. Well, wait a minute, let's do this. It's impossible to have world socialism. Let's do that. It's impossible to have true equality. Let's do that. So those would be ways in which we're thinking of the of identifying with the signifier of the lack and the other. And we can see this nicely, I think, in the opening of Agnès Varda's Sans Toi Ni Loi, translated in English, as vagabond. And the film begins with the corpse, basically, of a drifter. And it's interesting that Varda, and she's consciously echoing Citizen Kane. Kane takes the death of a very famous man. Varda takes the death of a forgotten woman as the point of departure. But precisely for that reason, I think she's focused on this drifter as it's herself a signifier of the lack and the other.
Monsieur Lanier, j'ai trouvé une femme là-bas, elle est morte, tu vois comme ça, hein?
Tu es sûr?
Deux dans la fossile, ah oui, oui, c'est sûr, hein?
Ah, je vais appeler les gendarmes.
Non, elle me rassure, ça n'est jamais.
Fais une photo du visage. Le visage.
This homeless, nameless subject, I think, marks the place of the impossible signifier, and Varda's focus on her in the film indicates a critique of what is in the place of the impossible in contemporary capitalist society. And this living being intersects the signifying process and becomes a barred subject. So let's look at signification from the perspective of the subject now. And the encounter of the signifying process with the living being, what does it do? It produces a desiring subject that is split by signification. So the subject is necessarily split precisely because it has to operate through the signifier. And in this space that the signifier of the lack of the other opens up, that there's a failure within the symbolic structure, the desire of the subject can emerge, the desire that Jacques Lacan calls objet. So objet is the remainder of the signifying process that attracts, that is the subject's desire, because it's absent. So you can say, through the process of signification and quilting, the objet is the leftover, the remainder that's left behind. Or it's an absence that always stains the field for the subject, stains the visual field for the subject. And in Velázquez's painting Las Meninas, I think this becomes pretty clear. So what's interesting is Lacan sees the objet not in, say, the look of the people in the royal couple in the back. No, it's in the painting, which we can only see the back of on the far left and the far left of the image. So the fact that we cannot see is the thing that draws our desire in. So it has to be functioning, objet, as an absence within the visual field. So it occupies this position of an absence within the structure of signification. It doesn't have a signified. And the confrontation with this absence is for the subject inherently traumatic, precisely because it reveals what the signifying structure cannot explain. So it's the point of a gap within the signifying structure, and that's why it's traumatic both for the signifying structure and the subject itself. But the big other comes to the rescue. So the big other is a structure that derives from the symbolic order, but it provides the subject, the split subject, with an identity which has the appearance of wholeness. So it gives, it takes subjectivity and turns it into symbolic identity. That's the basic function of the big other. So it gives the split subject a symbolic identity, which is a place in the other where it can imagine overcoming its split. So it becomes thinkable to overcome one's self-division, self-splitting. The big other, interestingly, also obscures the absence within the field of signification. So from the perspective of the big other, there is no signifier of the lack in the other, because the other is not lacking. The big other pretends to be, puts on a show of being, a non-lacking entity. And it tells the subject, as a result, that everything can be made meaningful. Everything can be reduced to sense. And this feeling that everything can be made meaningful, that everything is thus connected, that there's no gaps within the world of signification, is what Freud in Civilization's Discontents calls the oceanic feeling. So you might say the split subject encounters the big other and gains from this encounter this oceanic feeling. Here's what he says in Civilization's Discontents. It is a feeling which he, his friend Romain Rolland, would like to call a sensation of eternity, a feeling of something limitless, unbounded, as it were, oceanic. So this feeling of the connected, nothing is limited, there's no cut within the signifying structure or no cut within being. And the big other is what? It's the source of this feeling of belonging. So even if it's not an oceanic feeling, it's nonetheless a feeling like I really belong. And belonging allows us to believe that the big other completes us, that it fills our lack, that our two lacks come together and form a complementary whole. I think there's maybe no better example of the psychic power of the big other than in the film Heathers. There are numerous examples in this film. I'm just going to show you one little short one.
If you're going to openly be a bitch,
it's just Heather. Why can't we talk to different kinds of people?
Fuck me gently with a chainsaw. Do I look like Mother Teresa? If I did, I probably wouldn't mind talking to the geek squad.
Did you see that? Heather number one just looked right at me.
Does it not bother you that everybody in this school thinks that you're a piranha?
Like I give a shit. They all want me as a friend or a fuck. I'm worshipped Westerberg, and I'm only a junior.
So what I love is the people being utterly scorned by Heather Chandler. Just when she looks at them, they feel recognized and it makes their week. So I think we, and also, of course, fuck me gently with a chainsaw. That should be quoted much more often, I think. So the point is that the big other hides any absence in the symbolic order. It hides both the subject's own lack and the lack in the other. And because of the big other, we can't see that every signifying answer is necessarily incomplete and groundless, because it refers back to the ground of the master signifier, which itself has no ground. Right? That's why every answer is groundless. And to confront this groundlessness of signification and of our being is, I think, the existential task. The big other is lacking, however, and the missing signifier of this lack is S.A. Bard, the signifier of the lack in the other. And if we recognize the importance of this absent signifier, so it's recognizing the importance of absence, what's not included, what doesn't belong, we can break the hold that the big other has on us and act in ways that don't rely on the foundation that the master signifier provides. And that's the key to any kind of radical act. So there's always space for emancipatory political activity because there's always a missing signifier. There's always this signifier of the lack in the other, this S.A. Bard. I think it's fair to say the most important signifier is the one that isn't there. So the signifier of the Bard other, S.A. Bard, the signifier of the lack in the other, is missing, but it's the most important signifier. So how do we relate to it? What does that mean? So if we identify with that, what does it mean for the rest of our relation to signification? For instance, what does it mean for our relationship to the master signifier? Can we continue to believe in the master signifier once we've identified ourselves with the signifier of the lack in the other? Well, the problem is that you kind of have to. You have to still believe in the master signifier because that provides the basis for signification. But the crucial step, I think, and I think this is one thing, a step that people don't typically make, is to grasp the stupidity of the master signifier, that it doesn't itself have any sense. And that can be, I think, the basis for a radical act. So if you no longer believe that America has a sense, then you no longer constrained by what it means to be American.